Now, I'm going to talk about symplectic homeomorphisms. We know that M omega is symplectic manifold. And symplectic geometry is, by its very nature, something smooth. Is smooth. However, there are many manifestations that this smooth thing underlines a certain topology. But by topology, you all know what this means. This means some phenomena which depend just on smooth, on continuous map instead of smooth. And there are many manifestations. Müller, Stefan named several of them. Actually, my talk is a continuation of Stefan's talk. Now, and so the thing we want to do whenever you have an object, you want to study the automorphism group of this object. The automorphism of this, say, symplectic topology, where there is, the word is not well chosen because simplex topology means already something else. But this is why I put this between quotation. Now, there is not just one definition. People can make many definitions, but there is one definition we are going to stick to, is a definition which was proposed by O and Müller. We are going to call the this automorphism group, we're going to call it simple. This, by definition, this is the group of symplectomorphism of M, but closed inside the group of homeomorphism. Okay. And simple means symplectic homeomorphism. Here, homeo has the C0 topology. Okay. But because we are going to talk about a sequence and convergence sequence, I would like to describe this topology by a metric. There is this is a metric topology defined by a certain metric, and the distance between two elements, H and G, in H and omega, to define the distance, I'm going first to choose a distance on the manifold, D0, a distance on the manifold, and for instance, a distance which is given by a Riemannian metric. But it's not necessary. I define this by the soup, the max h of d0 hx gx, and the max of d0 g inverse x h0 h inverse g inverse x, and the max over x, and the sup of these two quantities. So this is a metric which define the Cézanne topology. Now, the first thing these two guys did is to try to understand what should be understood by a Hamiltonian system with a continuous function. Yeah.
I would say that this is our definition. This is supposed to be the definition
of Eliashberg. Oh, thank you.
I mean, he didn't say it, define it, but that's okay.
Yeah, but because I know that Zender proposed another definition, for instance, the homomorphism which preserve a capacity. This is another definition. But anyways, we are going to work with this definition here. Now,
definition as well. Sean Bates had a definition using capacities as well.
You like it better?
No. I like that.
Anyways, a definition is a definition, you work with it, and if you don't like it, you choose your definition and you work with it. Okay? Now, I was saying that the first thing these two guys did is to try to understand what should be called a Hamiltonian homeomorphism. And which they called a homeomorphism. Okay. Basically, it would be the following. Suppose that I have a sequence of Hamiltonian systems. The motion of Hamiltonian systems are the one parameter group generated by a function, and I have this sequence which is going to converge to something, C0, and the limit, of course, is going to be a homeomorphism, and I want that this limit has a Hamiltonian. And then the Hamiltonian would be, moreover, the limit of the Hamiltonians. But this doesn't make sense. Does this make sense? Yes, under certain topology. So we have to create a topology which is called the Hamiltonian topology. It's this one. So first of all, we look at a function H, a function from M0, 1 into R, smooth. And as we have been seeing it in all this conference, there is a vector field called XH, family of vector field, which is defined by the equation of, I put a plus, sorry, Michael. but it doesn't matter too much here. And so this is a family of vector field. Actually, take the derivative in X, and this family of vector field generates a family of diffeomorphism I call XH, so phi TH, where T phi 0 H is the identity, and D phi DT, DTH, DT, the point X is equal to XH, phi TH, X. So this is just the solution of these differential equations. This gives me phi, and I'm going to call this a Hamiltonian isotopy. This is a Hamiltonian. Now, we see that Hamiltonian isotopies, they're just defined by H through the differential. So they are defined by H if they are normalized. So, Hamiltonian isotopy, they are one-to-one correspondence with C infinity M. These are normalized. functions. And normalized means that if M is compact, the integral over M is zero, and if M is not compact, they have compact support. Now, so the idea is you have phi here, you assign the Hamiltonian corresponding to it. Now, I'm going to put on this space, you put this topology. First of all, with the top, the arm of phi h, phi l. If I have two Hamiltonian, this first of all is d bar max sup t 0 1 of d bar of phi t h phi t l. This is the c 0 part plus the Hofer norm h minus l. This is the Hofer norm. And let me remind you the Hofer norm of, if I have V, the Hofer norm of this function is sub max, it's V depend of X, V, VXT, X and T, minus mean X, V x t, and I integrate this from 0 to 1. Okay, this is the Hofer norm. And also, we can consider another norm, which is I denote by infinity. This is just to consider the max over t of the max over x. And by the way, this guy is called the oscillation of V. So the oscillation is the max minus the mean. Okay. Okay, so this is the topology we want, and this topology is going to do the thing we want, because if we have a Cauchy sequence in this topology, this means that it's Cauchy with respect to the C0 topology and also Cauchy for the Hofer norm. And so I think this is a nice topology which is going to solve our miseries. So let me take phi Hn d h m Cauchy sequence. Okay, so and let me call phi h n the limit in the c zero gamma. So this is a path and this is a path, and of course my path start with the identity. And let me call phi gamma of 1. I will say that phi is Hamiltonian homeomorphism. So I should say if it's a Hamiltonian homeomorphism, it should have a Hamiltonian. And because now this was a Cauchy sequence, it converges, so dot Hn converge there to H, because it's Cauchy in the other topology. But this guy is in A1 infinity M01, which is kind of ugly, but it's something. And so we call, I'm going to say that this phi is a Hamiltonian homeomorphism with Hamiltonian edge. And again, this is not very good because I may have another sequence converging to gamma. And I have another Hamiltonian, and this is not very nice, because I want uniqueness of Hamiltonian. So we are going to assume that Hn converges to H uniformly, which is continuous, and then there's a theorem which said that in this case the Hamiltonian is unique. So basically it says that if I have F Hn converging C0 to gamma and phi is say Ln converging C0 to the same thing, and if Hn converge in any other norm where H, which is continuous, and Ln converges to L, which is continuous, then L should be equal to H. So this means that in this case we have a continuous Hamiltonian which is unique and which is going with gamma. So this gives you a feeling that then gamma is a Hamiltonian homeomorphism because it is a Hamiltonian. Now this fact, this theorem is due to several people, and in some case it's due to Viterbo. Another case is due to O, and another case probably is due to Müller O. Okay, I don't remember who came first. Probably this came first, this after, and this, or the other way around.
Yeah,
Viterbo first.
Closed case.
Yeah.
There is no this joint work for this one.
Yeah.
Viterbo and O.
Mm-hmm.
There's no more. There's no mirror
in this. Okay. Sorry, mirror. Yeah. Okay. Now.
The canvas was proved in our paper, in our joint paper.
Mm-hmm.
The canvas. If
yeah.
The Hamiltonian is so the same, then the path is the same.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now. What I have trying to understand for a couple of years is to generalize this situation to the whole group of simple ectomorphisms. So and Müller, they define a set they call Hameo and Omega. Let me just say Hameo, not to waste time. And Hameo contains Ham, the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, and actually is a normal subgroup, and it's not the same, and this is contained in simple O, and which is contained in homeo. Okay.
You mean the normal sign should be in the
second
after, right? Second inclusion.
The second inclusion. Here.
Right. It's not when you conjugate. It's not smooth anymore.
Oh, okay. All right. And it's in there. Now, I'm going to show you how to construct another group here in between. And the group, I called it SS simple. I mean by strong simple ectomorphism. And so this is going to be here, it's going to be normal here, and this question I don't know yet if it's equal or not, but it's there. Okay, now how do you do this? First of all, I try to generalize this topology to the set of to the iso symplectic isomorphism. This is the set of all phi which are phi of t, and phi of t is a mapping from M to M, which is a symplectomorphism phi t. Preserve alpha omega, and I'm going to assume that from now on I'm going to assume that M is compact. This is a hypothesis I put. So I take this isotopies, of course, but we want that phi of zero is equal to the identity, and the fact that the isotropy preserves omega means that the family of vector field I denote by phi dot. This is the family of the of vector field which we take the point, the path through x, and you look at the tangent vector at this point x. This vector can be defined by S. D phi t dt at phi t minus 1 x. Okay? So, this vector field, the fact that this this preserve omega, phi t preserve omega, if and only if the lead derivative of omega is equal to 0. Which means exactly that I phi dot omega is equal is closed. Okay. In the case of Hamiltonian vector field, if phi is equal to phi h, we see that, and this is phi t h, we see that phi t h dot is just a x h in the case of Hamiltonian vector field. Okay? And of course, if you do this, I x f omega is df, the h is closed. Actually, it's exact. Well, now, it's well known that this Hofer norm on isotropy gives a norm actually on the group of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms by taking the inf of this thing over all Hamiltonians generating the diffeomorphism. This gives you a norm. And this norm is a very famous guy, which has the property to be bi-invariant, and which is very fancy. Now, I tried first to try to construct a norm using this thing. And there is no natural thing, there is no natural way to do it. And so, however, I did the following. Let me take simp, little simp, M omega, the set of symplectic vector field. This vector field, X, such that I X omega is closed. Okay. Now, I choose a Riemannian metric and I have already an orientation given by omega n. When you have these two ingredients, you can use Hodge theory. Oh, Austerity tells me that I can write this one form as in a unique way as a harmonic one form plus the U, and U X is a harmonic and U is smooth function and in a unique way. Okay. Now I'm going to define now the norm of this vector as the norm of H plus the Hofer norm of U. Of course, this is an extension of what I had in the case where this was exact. Because if it is exact, this is zero, and they have this. So I define the norm of X to be a norm of H plus the oscillation of U. Okay. And here, the norm of H don't have to be very fancy, because H is the set of harmonic one form with respect to a Riemannian metric G is a finite dimensional vector space. So I can take any norm here and it will be okay.
But this norm is not invariant under the action of simplicity.
No.
So maybe you can take just the infimum of all Riemannian metric G.
Actually, I'm going to show you that this thing, which depends on G, is the topology induced is independent of G. So this is a theorem that for any Riemannian metric G prime, then X G is equivalent to G prime. This is a beautiful fact due to the Hodge theory precisely of uniqueness, etc. So for instance, the idea is to take a basis in the harmonic forms of G and express this vector there and write this metric as the Euclidean metric, and then express and take this basis, use the Hodge decomposition, this Hodge issue, using this thing, and get a new basis, and then show that you have an inequality between this and the certain number time the other one, and vice versa. So it's really nice. So the moral of this is that at the end of the day, I have a metric on S ISO of M, which is in one-to-one correspondence with the space of smooth mapping into SIM M by, if I have an isotropy phi, I assign to it phi dot t okay. So I put a distance and a norm over here as this. So I write d. Let me call d zero of phi. D zero phi psi. Okay. I get the integral from 0 to 1 of H phi T minus H of psi t plus the position of u phi t minus v phi t, and I integrate the whole thing dt. And this is not very good. Let me call this sub-zero, and I call the of phi psi to be this zero of phi psi plus this zero of phi inverse psi inverse, and I divide by two. Okay, so this is going to give it a symmetric distance on this space or this space. Now, so I have the one part of the topology. I am going to add the other one. So I'm going to define the symplectic distance on the symplectic isotopy as phi psi as d sub over t of d bar phi of t psi of t. This is the first part, and plus to the one d phi and psi. Okay. Now, so we get a natural topology on S symplectic isotopies. So we get natural G on S iso. Okay. I insist that if I was considering the Hofer norm, I was considering the nth of all these things over all the isotopies relating to element in the group of symplectomorphisms, I can prove that I get a norm. But this norm is not equal to the norm, the Hofer norm, when it is restricted to the symplectic diffeomorphisms, Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. Actually, this norm is not going to be bi-invariant, unfortunately. Yeah. But it's a norm which generalizes the Hofer norm, and I call it Hofer-like norm. Okay, so now now I have what I need. I have the symplectic topology. So I'm going to define what's a strong symplectic diffeomorphism, homeomorphism. So phi is a strong symplectic homeomorphism if there exists a Cauchy, a D-simp Cauchy sequence phi n, because it's Cauchy, so it converges C0 to some gamma t. In gamma t homeomorphism, and we want gamma, of course, gamma zero is t density, and we want gamma one to be phi. Okay, this is what I'm going to call a symplectic homeomorphism, a strong symplectic homeomorphism, and I'm going to call S simp AO all of all symplectic, strong symplectic homeomorphism. First of all, you can see that all the homeos are inside. Because the homeos within the same way. And because the ham and the simp restrict to this one, the ham on Hamiltonian isotropy. Okay? So I have this guy contains a simple O contains Hameo. Okay? And of course it's contained in simple O. Of course, which is contained in homeo. Okay. I have this, and what's the main result is that this guy is a topological group. So I have the following theorem: one S. A simple O is topological group okay. This is the main part or the main result, and the second, which is this is simple, a homeo Hameo is a normal subgroup of simple O. And three, Hameo is equal to simple O if M is simply connected okay. And the last one is that the commutator subgroup of S simple O is contained in Hameo. Well, most of this they're not hard to prove. But the first part is very involved to prove that the composition of things stay. If you have two Cauchy sequences and you compose them, you get a Cauchy sequence. That this is very involved. This is very involved. The other are not involved. Okay. Now, actually, let me give you how you get the composition. Let me call G the set of the limit of the Cauchy sequences. In a SISO. So these are made of gamma in homeo, which are the limit of phi n, and quantity equal v, which is h u, where H is the limit of the Hamiltonian, the harmonic part of phi n, and u is the limit of the Hamiltonian part of phi n. So the limit is done of these two triggers, and the addition is defined this way. What you expect, the addition would be gamma h u multiplied by gamma prime h prime u prime is the first two terms are what you expect. The first two terms are gamma prime. The second term is h plus h prime, and the last term is more complicated. It's u plus u prime composed of gamma plus another term v, which I don't want to write here because it's too long. And the inverse gamma h u inverse is the first is what we expect. It's gamma inverse, and the other is minus h, and the other one is minus u gamma plus another term I don't want to write, but which I have explicitly, but I can write it. So these are the rule, and you can prove that this multiplication and inverse are continuous. Now, this is about everything I want to say, and I want to say something about the F equations. First of all, I don't know if this is strict.
Can I ask you? Yeah? Is it always the, so? Is it the, when you take this product?
Mm-hmm.
Is it obvious to see the harmonic part is added up?
Yes. Oh. Yeah, this is obvious, but when the harmonic precisely the fact that the Hodge theory says that the harmonic part is unique determines uniquely the cohomology class. So if when you compose two things, you're going to compose with the second is going to be composed by the diffeomorphism of the first. Mm-hmm. Okay? And this is has the same Durham cohomology as the other one. Mm-hmm. So it will be the second harmonic plus something which is messy, and I put all the thing messy over there. So this is clear here. And this is a good indication that there is a possibility of creating a Karabi invariant on this group. I have almost all the ingredients to create it. Yeah. Okay. So the first question is to know. This is not obvious at all, if this is I equal or not. I don't know. Yeah. And actually, this question, the second question is to know if Hameo is equal to the commutator subgroup. This This probably.
Yeah. This D must be very complicated.
This V is kind of complicated. There is a formula, but the formula is not nice.
Okay.
Yeah. I have the formula of these two, but they are not nice, but there are formulas.
Okay.
Because what you see, when you compose these two isotopes, they are. And you decompose the product, you are going to see the harmonic part of the first is okay. The other part, if you write the whole thing, you are going to get the harmonic part of the second is composed with the diffeomorphism, the first diffeomorphism, and this is no longer harmonic. So we have to do the whole decomposition again,
mm-hmm.
and have the harmonic part, which is the same as the one without F, but there is all these things you put under the rug, under this name.
Okay.
And if we could know this, and I think this is related. One of these questions, or both, would solve the Fatih's questions. On S2. Okay.
Sorry, what does
a
2 bracket?
Please?
2?
2 bracket. Oh, sorry, it's just 1 bracket. Thank you. 1 bracket. Yeah. Yeah. Now, maybe I have a few minutes. Let me show you how the metric is independent of the Riemannian metric. This distance is independent of the Riemannian metric. Okay. It's very nice. You say that, so I have simp m omega, little s, so I have a vector field here. This vector field omega is h plus du. By the choice of a Riemannian metric, you get this, and if we choose another Riemannian metric, you get the same thing is h prime plus d u prime. Okay. Now, you do the following: you choose a basis, let b be b1 br basis of harmonic one form with G. By the way, a harmonic form is a form so that dH, delta H, equal to 0. It's a form which is closed and co-closed. And delta is the codifferential. And star is the whole star. Now, so the thing I do, I decompose each bi as I apply Hodge theory to bi using g prime. So g prime, in g prime the bi becomes bi prime plus dvi. This decomposition is unique, but as G prime harmonic forms, so B prime I is G prime harmonic. Okay? So the first remark is to observe that if I call B prime the set of all B prime 1, B prime R, this is a basis again. Because if we assume that these are not linear independent, there's a linear combination which is zero, and you use this fact, you see that you're going to have a linear combination of harmonic forms which is exact. And this is impossible because harmonic form represents a cohomology. So they must be zero, and you conclude that this is a basis. Now, you can see that when this is H can be written in the first basis as lambda I, say BI. And let me consider now a lambda I B prime I instead. And I make the sum of this, and I call this H double prime. This is B, this is a G prime harmonic form. Okay, and this harmonic form represent is representative of I x omega, because I x omega it was represented by this guy, and these are cohomologous. So this is representing of the same the cohomology class of omega, and because it's unique, by uniqueness, we say that H prime, double prime is equal to H prime, and so on. So we see that if you look at the norms in this basis of H, and the norm of H prime in the other basis, they're the same. Now I have to adjust the oscillations. And adjusting the oscillations give an inequality. So we see that here, the H, the norm, using the first basis is the same of this, and it's going to be the same as the H prime in B prime. So this way, I see that the first part adjusts very well, and I have to adjust the oscillations. And adjusting the oscillation gives rise to an inequality of this type. X, G is a certain constant time X, G prime. And vice versa, you get an inequality of this type. Okay. So, and this, I think this is very nice because this guy, this set, has an intrinsic topology. Which is independent of the choice of the Riemannian matrix.